With that, I would like to invite Dr. Mukul Vich for his next talk on chronic rejection. I mean, we all know Mukul very well. He's a consultant histopathologist and the director of laboratories at the Raela Institute. He has a very specific interest and a lot of experience in transplant pathology, both renal and liver transplant. Dr. Mukul, please.
Can you see my slides?
Yes, Mukul, we can.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for the invitation for this immunosuppression meet in hepatology. And rushed through, I think I have very less time. So I was given the task of chronic rejection, pathologist perspective. What I will show you actually images at what you see in chronic rejection, starting from the transition phase when you are seeing from it is transitioning from a unresponsive acute rejection to the late phases when you see a burnt out and burnt out phase with some amount of fibrosis. So how you define chronic rejection is an immune-mediated damage to the liver allograft that is associated with potentially irreversible injury to the bile duct and vasculature. And it's important that most of the time we diagnose chronic rejection, we diagnose on in biopsy. So adequate biopsy should be, a pathologist should be provided with adequate biopsy, which means an ideal biopsy is actually should have 20 or more pull tracks, but otherwise even 11 pull tracks will do to characterize chronic rejection. So now chronic rejection is actually quite rare, affects less than 3% of allografts and usually occur more than 3 months after transplantation. Typically, many times it is preceded by the unresponsive T-cell mediated rejection, but can occur after many years after transplant insidiously. And patient usually will present with progressive jaundice and cholestatic pattern of abnormal serum chemistries. Rarely you can have acute vanishing bile duct syndrome, which is extremely rare now, but still you can rarely see it. And main morphological features, the diagnostic duo is dystrophic epithelial changes in the bile duct with duct loss and obliterative arteriopathy, which affects large and medium-sized arteries. So there are early stages and late stages. In early stages, you see degenerative or senescent duct epithelial changes, which is characterized by, I'll show you, nuclear enlargement, hyperchromasia, pleomorphism, multinucleation, cytoplasmic eosinophilia, and vacuolization. You can see in the starting, you will see inflammatory cell infiltrate, which will be mononuclear, not mixed, what you see in acute TCMR. There in the starting, you will also continuously see lymphocytic infiltration of the bile duct. And if you do some IHC, it will show markers of replicative senescence like P21 or stress-related factor or EMT transition S100A4 would be positive. So this is the typical the biopsy. What you see, you can see a background of there is still inflammation. This is transition phase. A TCMR which is not responding to steroids and or other medications, and you can see a bile duct here which is showing typical the dystrophic changes. You can see so much loss of polarity. You can see there is high cytoplasmic ratio. There is so much the nuclear size and shape of each of them is very, very different, and you can see the lumen also distorted lumen, and you can see occasional lymphocytic infiltration. Background, you are seeing some amount of moderate inflammation, which is mononuclear lymphocytes and histiocytes. Very rare eosinophil you can see. In some stages, you can also see apoptosis or death of the of the bile ducts. You can see this is very pycnotic cell here. This very eosinophilic cytoplasm. This is apoptosis is happening in the bile duct. Destruction of the bile duct. The bile duct still there, but destruction of the duct cells have started, and still you are seeing background inflammation. It's still there, which is again predominantly mononuclear. Later stages, as it progresses and you do repeat biopsy, you continuously to treat patient don't respond, and you repeat a biopsy, then you don't see much inflammation. Again, you can see much dystrophic epithelial changes in the bile duct here. All the bile ducts are showing extensive dystrophic changes. However, inflammation is markedly reduced now. And in the adjacent parenchyma, you are starting seeing features of ballooning and cholestasis also. So these are the early things. Apart from the portal area, I think central lobular lesions are very important, and they are very important in graft failure. You can see you will not see the typical venulitis, which is described in TCMR. In cases of chronic rejection, you will see cell loss and some inflammation. You will see lymphocytes, and you will also see a lot of macrophages, which can also have a lot of degenerated pigment inside them. You can see ballooning of the hepatocytes, and you can see congestion hemorrhage also because of the central lobular injury. you will not see the endo, the venulitis which is described earlier in the CMR is usually not seen. In this case, you can again see inflammation and necrosis of the hepatocyte throughout. You can see ballooning and cholestasis and congestion also. So these are very important in the progression or the evolution of chronic rejection. These changes in more severe changes, you can even see necrosis. Here you can see bridging necrosis. Along with that, there is ballooning and cholestasis in the adjacent cytoplasm. Inflammation also, you can see variable inflammation in the biopsies. Important part is this necrosis will continue even if in multiple biopsy you can progress. You can do multiple biopsies at certain interval in a month or 2 months. You continues to treat patient, but necrosis around the central, it continues, and you see very limited fibrosis. Like in this case in trichome, there is hardly any fibrosis, but necrosis still going on with very minimal inflammation. Later on, as it progresses, you reach the stage of late chronic rejection and you start seeing a burnt out appearance of the portal tract. Here you can see there is complete duct loss. This is an arteriole. There are arterioles here. There is vein with some fibrosis here, but there's no duct and very, very minimal inflammation. The burnt out here also, you can see a vein. Vein is unremarkable. You can see an arteriole well formed here also, but you can see no duct and you can see some macrophages with pigment. So this is the late CR in which you are seeing duct loss in the biopsy. Most of the time in late CR, you see that there is no ductal reaction as compared to other bilirubin disorders. However, when you see chronic rejection associated with chronic hepatitis, you can see some ductal. Like in this case, in which there is evidence of chronic hepatitis, where probably 9 or 10 years post transplant, you can see some ductal reaction around it also. But this is usually a less common feature as compared. Most of the cases, you will not see any ductal reaction because of the apoptosis as well as inhibition of the proliferative activity. Apart from that, you can also see artery loss. Here you can see a duct with a lot of degenerative changes. You can see a lot of macrophages, but you don't see any artery. And this is also important in the evolution of chronic rejection, that there is arterial loss, which can lead to allograft failure. And other late features which are important, you can see bile lakes and presence of foam cells. Foam cells is considered a late feature. And when you see most of the time, the CR has progressed to the point of no returns. You can see multiple foam cell clusters here, along with extensive cholestasis in the lobular parenchyma. This is a pediatric allograft. This is a referral biopsy from other center, and you can see this is within a month of pediatric transplant. There was complete ductopenia with cholestasis and foam cells in this biopsy. Rarely you can see in some of the cases of acute vanishing bile duct syndrome. It's quite rare now. Nowadays, if you do copper stains in late stages of CR, you can also see some periportal copper deposition. Here you can see the red granules in rhodanine stain. CK7 immunostaining can act as an adjunct to this, that if you do this stain, you can confirm the duct loss. You can see the arteriole and vein, there is no duct, and the periportal metaplasia of the hepatocytes, the hepatocytes expressing the CK7 immunostains, which is a metaplastic response. Another feature which is known is obliterated arteriopathy. You don't see needle biopsies because they affect medium and last side ducts. This is an expand liver. You can see a lot of scarring here, extensive cholestatic expand. Again, you can see there is hardly any fibrosis. It's very cholestatic expand, and there is no evidence of any nodule formation. So in CR, most of the cases, there is the fibrosis is very minimal, and it's mostly in the portal, periportal, and some in the central lobular area. Bridging and as such is not so common. To show you from this expand, you can see some perivenular fibrosis and portal fibrosis here, but there is no evidence of any bridging septa formation. So coming to obliterated arteriopathy, which is again important feature in the chronic rejection, you will see in the explant field graphs, usually affect large and medium sized muscular artery. And these are the typical features. I'll not go into pathogenesis. This is a typical artery. You can see this lot of foam cells. This is the lumen completely obliterated, and you can see collection of the foam cells along with some lymphocytes also you can see in this obliterated arteriopathy. You can also see at the late succulae, which is intimal fibrosis in the arteries at the hilum, like in this one, eccentric, you can see eccentric fibrosis here. In some of the grafts, early grafts, if you happen to see after retransplantation, you can also see some lymphocytic inflammation in the artery, apart from some histiocytes. So in the early stages, you can see some lymphocytic arthritis also. Now, apart from that, there are which is very less talked about in chronic rejection. If you study the retransplanted explants, is fibro-obliterative lesions of the veins. It affects hepatic veins as well as portal veins. most commonly small hepatic vein branches, terminal hepatic vein branches are involved, but later as there is stasis and thrombosis, you will see involvement of medial size, and even larger hepatic veins can see obstruction or fibro-obliterative changes, and they can show eccentric or concentric fibrosis, and they can also show recanalization, which shows that there is stasis and thrombosis. Like this one, this is the most common feature in transplant. You see, these are the central veins completely obliterated. You can see some red cells here, obliterated central vein, extensive cholestasis around, and around that there is hardly any fibrosis. Here also you can see obliteration of the terminal hepatic venule. In the larger veins, you can see there is recanalization, there is thrombosis. So this is evidence because of the stasis and obstruction of the smaller veins, and stasis, you can see thrombosis and recanalization and obliteration of the hepatic veins. Here also you can see complete obliteration of the hepatic vein in an explant. Fibrosis is extremely rare. If you see, there is chronic hepatitis in the chronic idiopathic transplant hepatitis with chronic rejection, or sometimes you can see bridging fibrosis. Like in this case, there is portal area and there is with duct loss. This is a central vein. There is extensive fibrosis, eccentric fibrosis, reduction in the lumen, and you can see bridging septa formation. Here you can see the typical centrizonal fibrosis connecting the both central vein here and this here. So this is also a late feature. When you see, these are all our late features in a case of chronic rejection. Portal vein, again, when you see a lot of hepatic vein changes in an allograft, you can also see the typical changes what you see in portal vein thrombosis in any other case of liver disease. You can see typical intimal fibrosis, even foam cells, presence of foam cells. I have not seen foam cells, but even presence of foam cells have been described in these cases of rejection. Again, there are early and chronic. You can go through this from the BAMF classification. There are early and late stages of chronic rejection, and you can see different features. Basically, for most important for us is chronic ductopenic rejection, because we diagnose a needle biopsy is loss of ducts in more than 50% of the portal tract. Differential diagnosis again are other biliary diseases, including recurrent PBC, PSC, or ischemic cholangiopathy, but they always show presence of ductal reaction, which chronic rejection, we hardly see ductal reaction in cases of chronic rejection. A word on CAMR. CAMR can occur. It can occur in patients who have persistent de novo or persistent DSA, especially against class 2. And what has been described now, these are the criteria which has been described in the AJT paper in 2016. I'll show you. This is the finding which have been described. You see the typical finding what you see in non-cirrhotic portal fibrosis. There is extensive collagenation in this portal area. There is intimal fibrosis with reduction in the lumen of the portal vein. You don't see much inflammation. Duct is still there, not much changes in the duct, but you see extensive like glide-like changes have been described in cases of CMR, apart from the other mild perivenular inflammation. C4D you can do in chronic AMR, like in this case of you, but mostly it is very, very less, more than 10% of capillary should show. Like in this case, you can see in this.
Dr. Mukul, could you wind up?
Yeah, just done. This is the C4D in a case of chronic AMR. Thank you. Thank you.